time you're not gonna listen to us in Spanish as you always do. Why? Because it's us.
This is the D-Strip-Ando in English.
Pretty much that's the accent that you're gonna hear for the next 20 minutes, okay?
And no, it's not a comedy special. This is the Detrás del Micro, or what is the section?
Detrás del Micro.
And we're not in English.
Okay.
Just another brick in the wall. Okay, that's pretty much. So this is
100 celebration.
So that's pretty much. He's gonna take the command of the reins of the whole show. Okay.
No, the Bolshoi.
The Bolshoi. He's gonna dance. He's gonna sing. He's gonna strip.
No.
It's not another podcast, please. We need. You will get that if we get more patrons. So just stand out. So we're right now do a brief. Introduction to the DC Animated Universe, right?
That's pretty much.
So we have about, what is it, 4 or 5 titles that are the main?
We have 5 animated pictures that we can call the new 52. It all comes right from Flashpoint, the Paradox. Flashpoint Paradox is the name of the movie. And then...
Flashpoint Paradox?
The Flashpoint Paradox, that's right. The second movie, we can say that pretty much all the movies that we have seen in recent years, and now 2-3 years from Flashpoint Paradox, it's the adaptation of all the first arcs of the Justice League, all written by Geoff Johns,
yep.
Some drawn by Jim Lee, some drawn by Ivan Reis.
Ivan Reis, like Throne of Atlantis.
And some other stuff that is pretty much...
This is kind of job Geoff Johns' verse, no?
That's correct.
Basically,
yeah, the
free adaptation.
We can call it the...
Not free.
Loose.
I think that you may remember that there was some time that it was the Timbers.
Yeah.
The Bruce Timbers. And we can call this this era of the animation, the Geoff Johns era.
One thing that I want to mention about that is that it's the kind of handling that they are having is because the Geoff Johns is responsible for most of the most beloved recent stories from some of the characters. And actually, the main reason is because he became the head of DC Brothers' media department.
I will go with the second one because it's the most beloved.
I was about to say that.
By himself. Most beloved by himself. Allow me to correct myself.
That makes a lot of sense.
Okay.
No, it's your case. I wouldn't go that far as the most beloved. But I would say just the initial arcs, the initial stories of the new DC universe, we can say that the Justice League is the group that ties all the universe together. I don't know if we can call it the best stories because we can remember that during the first 2 years of Justice League, the stories were pretty lame and with no much sense, no more tying.
Boring.
So boring.
Boring.
I will risk you
probably Throne of Atlantis, that it was the
peak
of that 2 years, probably.
I know the peak, but the most interesting, yes.
Yeah.
I would say, yeah, the most interesting. The other, the less boring.
The less boring.
That is the Jumpers, the same. Mm-hmm. Because Aquaman. It was also written by himself.
Yeah. Aquaman wrote himself?
No.
That one power you don't see every day. But, well, actually, it all began with
the adaptation
of the Flashpoint Paradox. We can see that the drawing style is not quite the same as the rest of the universe. We can see that there are some subtle changes within the movie. If you compare it with the four-issue comic book story. For instance, the Justice League or the group that Cyborg is trying to gather to, I don't know, to battle Aquaman and Wonder Woman.
To stop the war.
To stop the war. To save the war. to stop the war, to save the war. It's not pretty much the same as in the comic books. I think that the concept is Barry Allen. I don't know why they bring back Barry Allen again. But then again,
Geoff Johns.
Then again, that he is the fastest man alive in the lowest comic ever written. We can see. I think that the most interesting character in the whole series, once again, is Batman. This time is not Bruce Wayne. This time is Thomas Wayne.
The Doctor.
Dr. Wayne. Dr. Wayne. We can see, I think that the most interesting part is sometimes I just see Captain Thunder, Shazam, Captain Marvel, all the kids. We don't happen to see how the Mysterian people or the Amazons sank, Aquaman sank Europe, and how Themyscira took by force Britain.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. So I think that you could have a 3-hour movie that could be full of nonsense. But then again, as in the comic books, it's the mark where you can say, okay, we are changing the guard, we are beginning with new stories, and from now on, all you're going to see is not the kind of characters, not the customs that you're used to, and not the language that you are used to recognizing the movies.
It's totally. a flashpoint.
A flashpoint.
Actually, I believe that that's the main reason why they started this new part of the universe. With that story, because it's like a brand new order that they are taking in here, mm-hmm. and that actually brings us to the next story, which is the Justice League War. Just mentioning there, because Justice League War is within the same continuity.
Yes, but no.
Yeah, no.
You can say that it's not from the same continuity, because there's an usual mistake that's made within the comics. All people refer to as the Flashpoint universe, and no.
There is no Flashpoint, but there is a five-issue Flashpoint universe.
Yeah, there's a Flashpoint universe, and right after the Flashpoint 4, it's the New 52.
The New 52 is the consequence of that event.
Totally right, and it's another issue totally. So we can say that right after the Flashpoint paradox, the only thing that keeps continuity within all the rest of the movies is Batman and the Flash, right. And all of this thanks to the letter that Thomas Wayne wrote to Bruce and gave it to Barry and Ron.
Actually, that's a technique that was developed so he wouldn't mess with the continuity.
Again. So that's pretty much the end of... I think that the most significant change, and the most shocking one, and I think that it was better suited for the movie, in comparison with the rest of the comic books, is that we see that Thomas Wayne slashes Zoom, Edward Wayne,
yeah,
with a sword. Deathstroke sword at the end of it. And in the movie, in the animation, we see with the same gun that killed Bruce, we have to remember that Martha Wayne wasn't killed within this continuation, that she became the Joker of Flashpoint. And with the same gun, right after he wrote the letter and gave it to Barry, he came from behind. When Zoom was noticing, he was distracting, blathering about how great he was. And he killed him, shooting him in the back of the head. That was pretty shocking, huh? And I think it was better suited. It was more blunt, but more...
Close the circle.
Yeah, right. That's pretty much the thing. Right after that, we can see Barry delivering the letter to Bruce at the Batcave. We can see how pussy Bruce can be. He was crying and weeping all over the letter. And at the end of Flashpoint.
But it's also the new story arc or the continuity that is going now on the comics, messing the Watchmen in the continuity and something like that.
The letter was part of Flashpoint. The thing about Watchmen and all that stuff is from reverse to now.
But it's consequence of Flashpoint.
I think it's consequence of all the stupid people that was in charge of this story.
I wouldn't blame the story.
Bob Harras.
No,
Dan Didio. Dan Didio.
Dan Didio's mosaic.
He will understand.
So now we have a new continuity. In the comic books, we were already used to see the Justice League getting together by fighting Starro, the Conqueror, giant starfish from space, or it was
the clown?
I'm gonna fit in here. I'm gonna hit you with something. But okay, the thing was this. We're pretty much it was the Grant Morrison version of Starro.
Yep. Or the
White Martian. Again and again and again and again. And that was pretty much it. With this new continuity, we were promised, and the promise was not fulfilled. It was failed. That we were going to have a big story, a great story, because my stories are the best. I have the best stories.
I have one best story that is not to start wrong. It's Darkseid.
Wow.
Yeah. It feels pretty awesome.
Sounds good.
Sounds good.
At the time, sounded amazing.
By number five, you get and the Parademons. Ah! There are the Parademons!
Number five, you were so fucking bored that you didn't give a shit about Darkseid anymore.
I agree.
So that what we see in war, it's called war. Why? Because as usual, Darkseid is trying to invade Earth. To you can say terraform, but no, because we're already on Earth.
Mm-hmm.
But
it's apocalypse, some shit like that.
Change the earth. One mention that we have to give in here is that, for example, in the comics, Darkseid is coming here after he destroyed Earth 2. And actually, he killed Superman, he killed Wonder Woman, he killed the Batman, the Trinity in there. And right now, he's coming in here. Bruce Wayne, you are correct there. And he's coming here after that present. So, for example,
Earth 2 is destroyed again?
No, just not some of the characters.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Well, you can see that it has been destroyed several times, actually. Eh?
Yeah.
Remember with the Asgardian gods and everything like that? Well, let's go back here.
Another.
That's for the 500th episode. But after that, well, Darkseid is coming. They are going to destroy Earth. You have the president that he is the destroyer of wars, of entire realities. And however, I believe that there is one thing that actually is done right in the animation. In similar style that it was in the Flashpoint paradox, because they are reducing the number of plots that they have, and it's, well, people want to look at Darkseid destroying things, so we don't have to have five issues of boring stuff, as my partners were saying in there.
That's pretty much right, but the problem is that you were promised a great story.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
A tale that's gonna
that was gonna change the way you see comic books. The way storytelling in comic books were about to change, and it was never delivered. The thing was, we see Superman that's totally out of character. Wonder Woman, no. Wonder Woman, I think that's pretty much within the same parameters of the rest. Why? Because Wonder Woman has never had a parameter or a way of being characterized outside Justice League Animated, and that was pretty much, I'm a tough bitch. And a hot one, and that was pretty much it.
And she likes ice cream.
And that
was only in the comics.
No, that was before Flashpoint Paradox. That's in the continuity. But then, Barry Allen was the problem with Barry Allen right after Flashpoint is his Wally West dressed like Barry Allen. That was pretty much it. We see a Superman that's without any mission, without any purpose. Little son of a bitch.
Superman versus Batman? Batman versus Superman?
No.
It feels pretty the same.
Only Wonder Woman in character.
You're about to see how do I speak my brother, regardless of the language I am speaking.
Come here!
Are you sure you don't want me to edit that out?
The speed.
What, please?
And right after that, we see a Green Lantern that's pretty much within the style of Geoff Johns.
Yeah.
In the comic books or any other part, because he's pretty constant within the animations. We can see First Light, great animation, and it's the same personality. We can see Emerald Knight.
Yep.
And even though he's not the main character in the whole movie, what little we can see of Hal Jordan, it's pretty much the same as in War.
Yeah.
Wonder
Woman.
That's what I said. If you were paying attention, that's what I said.
Yep.
Put attention.
pon atención.
¡Ah! ¡Ya entiendo!
And that we don't haven't seen Aquaman yet, and there's something that really bothers me. I don't know about you, but the inclusion of Shazam, or previously formerly known as Captain Marvel, I don't think I don't care. I don't give a fuck how great character he can be, because he can be a really great character.
Yeah.
But he's written so poorly, so lame-ish, that they say, okay,
it's what... basically a cameo, so...
I don't think it's a cameo, because he's really within the battle. He's really part of the battle. He's the cocky one, he's a... For someone who's supposed to have Solomon's capacities...
Solomon's wisdom.
Wisdom. So, that's right. He's pretty stupid.
He's a child. That's the problem. They forgot the
problem. They actually remember that he's based on the personality of Billy Batson. However, they are forgetting one thing. You have a powerhouse in Superman.
Yeah.
You cannot have someone with the similar powers. The Martian Manhunter was different because he had telepathic powers.
The Martian Manhunter was way above Superman because he's a shapeshifter, he's a telepath. He can
he's
turn
Martian.
Yeah, no, there's Kryptonian. He can turn invisible.
Ah, aliens.
Aliens.
Illegal.
Get a horse beneath the water.
He can ride a dog.
But it's pretty much the same like the comic. If you remember, the backstories of that issues, or boring issues of the first 2 years of JLA, it was the backstory of Shazam.
And even
that it was put by force in the Justice League. It was, it feels forced.
Because he sells better at those times, right?
Yep.
Yeah. So that's pretty much it. So my opinion is, Cyborg doesn't have nothing to do in the Justice League. Why? Because he's always a Teen Titan or a Titan. Actually, he was the bridge between generations with Teen Titans and the Titans. And
other books.
That's another thing that's pretty fucked up, being created instead of another dimension being White Solo with his mother.
Yeah.
That's what she said.
and
then suddenly a mother box came and transformed him.
From Batman.
Yes,
in this.
He is like the aborigine in X-Men.
The
same.
Gateway.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. So we can say that even though the interaction between Green Lantern and Batman, I think that's quite the most interesting during the whole movie, we can say that's pretty failed, pretty much like the comic book.
Yeah.
I think that
and
we...
And in the book, comic book, also Batman and Green Lantern are the... Well...
Actually, it's Batman.
The less bad. The less bad.
Yeah.
So it's...
And then...
There came the king.
There came the king from the under the seas.
Under the sea. Under the sea.
Someone kill them and put him over the Mr. Raper.
Kill Sebastian, please.
Kill them and put me out of their misery.
But no, the thing is, we don't happen to see the king of the seven seas. We happen to see a poor, drunk boy.
Yeah. A millennial.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah,
that issues.
A lot of that issues, and I love the fact that the way Geoff Johns makes some jokes within the comic books, and all those jokes were reflected in the movie. That it was like, don't take him. I'm talking to him. He was talking to a lobster. Everybody was like, I want to eat
Sebastian.
It was Sebastian.
Get your movie right. Get your Marveliver.
It's Disney.
Get your movie right.
It was Sebastian from Earth 2.
It's Aquaman from Earth 2.
No. No, this is different. This is Arthur. We have to remember that the Aquaman from Earth 2 actually was an experiment. Mm-hmm. No, the Aquaman from Earth 2 was an experiment. The Aquaman from Earth 1 and eventually...
The 52. The new 52.
The new 52
and eventually
one. Rebirth and eventually any other version of Aquaman. It was the son of the Queen of Atlantis and Arthur Curry, who was a lightkeeper, and that was pretty much the origin of Aquaman. I think that the interesting part of all of this is we happen to see the evolution from, first of all, of the league, the Super 7, the Super 7, because at the beginning of the movie, Cyborg said, nobody comes here. So it was said to Steve Trevor, and we can see a league that's pretty much not tied together as we would like to. That's another epic fail, if you ask me. If you don't ask me, okay, I already told you. And that's pretty much it. Within this movie, we see a common menace that doesn't come from the outer space. It comes from the space below. And that's what she said. Okay, the love below. And shake it like a photo of a picture.
Yeah, you seem kind of Robert.
And then we can see the inclusion of Aquaman. We can see the origin, the secret origin of Ocean Master, which was kind of interesting, the same shit as usual, but with new threats. The same shit dressed in a different way. And the inclusion of Aquaman being the bridge between the Atlantean culture and the surface dwellers. Mm-hmm. And that was pretty much it.
In the comic books, one of the things that I believe it was the most interesting was the introduction of the Others, which is pretty much the Justice League underwater. Actually, what they had a title focused on those characters besides Aquaman.
Mm-hmm.
That was, I believe, that the only time that Aquaman appeared in two titles. Well, one of those was of teams. And for example, Throne of Atlantis, you have a common menace, you have a common enemy, as you mentioned here. But in the adaptation, in the animation, what was the highlight of this story?
Aquaman's mother being killed by Orms, Aquaman, as usual, reluctant to assume his position of king, and Aquaman reluctant to join the Justice League. We can say that all the writers and all the staff at DC Comics are pretty much decided to keep Aquaman as a loner, pretty much in a Batmanish style. I think, yeah, I'm a loner, but I have to be a king, and I have Mino, and I have Mera, and I have Volko. Pretty much like the Bat family. I'm a loner, but I have a lot of kids surrounding me.
No family, and I hide under the water, not under the behind the shadows, no?
Yeah. And I think that's one of the things that hasn't been explored as it was supposed to be explored is the presence of the Others. Because within the comics, it was just this strange race from way beneath even Atlantean's surface or down face, water face. And in the Others, I think it was like seven numbers, seven issues, eight issues, something like that.
Yeah.
And that was pretty much it. And we haven't seen her here or anything from them since then. So I think that was, again, a failed experiment. That it was supposed to be interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And no, actually, I was going to say that
because you are not going to listen. Well, that actually brings us to one of the best adaptations, and I believe that it's like the cross point between the Batman animated series and animated movies and the Young Justice TV show in a way. And we have finally the Justice League versus the Teen Titans. Well, the name says pretty much everything because you have the confrontation between two of the most beloved and better established teams that you have in the DC universe.
Long live Legion and the Legion of Superheroes.
And the Legion of Superheroes. But no. One question: actually, they have appeared in the new in this new continuity in the animation series.
No.
That's actually the importance that you have in there with the this is crazy camera time. No. That's Pico actually moving the camera, so you know how to blame. Now, because you have the young guns, which are the Teen Titans, that are having the crossover with the big guns in here. But who is the main villain in this series? Wookie, I don't know if you can tell us.
I don't remember.
You don't remember?
Dragon the Terrible? Dragon the Terrible. That's Titans. Yeah. That's the first start. And we can see it's something very interesting because we have the younger version of some Titans or the Teen Titans in the comics, and on the other hand we have two or three not original Titans,
the new
Teen Titans by Wolfman and Perry.
Yeah.
And so that was pretty much it. It was the kind of mix, kind of strange, kind of what the fuck is going on.
Yeah.
Because we see a grown-up Starfire, a grown-up Dick Grayson as Nightwing, and not that Robin. We see Damian Wayne, on the other hand, as a kid. We see the Blue Beetle, a kid. This boy has always been a character that nobody knows his age, because sometimes he's sometimes he's a child under 13.
He's changing.
He's a beast. And that's what Raven said. And we have Raven. Raven. The problem with Raven is sometimes he's depicted as a young woman, more or less around Starfire's age. And sometimes, like in this version, she's a little kid again. So that it's we can say that's pretty mixed. And I, the only thing that I didn't like about this movie is that the Grayson is not in it. Only for about 2 minutes, and that was pretty much it. But I think that the most important thing is about this movie is not the connection between the the New Teen Titans or the Titans and the Justice League. It's the development of extra-dimensional characters. We happen to see the real evil, a real demon, an interdimensional demon, the baddest motherfucker I ever seen in a fucking animated movie, which happens to be Trigon the Terrible. I think that the thing about the Justice League Titans is it's a kind of tie-in between the Batman animated movies that exist in the same universe, the Justice League movie, the two previous Justice League movies, like that we just mentioned, and what's to come. Yeah. Why? Because we see the relationship between Batman and Damian, between Batman, Green Lantern, he's stupid, Green Lantern, between Batman and Superman, Superman and Wonder Woman, and how everybody is afraid of Damian. Yeah, I'm gonna stop Superman. You're gonna be able to, you have a way to stop Superman. Oh fuck, I think that he has a way to stop Superman. Kryptonite. Yeah, so that was pretty much it. And the way that Damian is introduced to the Teen Titans, I think it was pretty cool. I think it was the right way. It was the right way.
Yeah.
Unlike the comic, actually, where Damian takes over the Teen Titans, he kidnaps them and takes over the leadership, the leader, so-called leadership of the group.
They're my bitches.
There's also one other thing that happens in the series that actually is trying to correct part of the mistakes that were done actually in the comic books, but also in the movies, because Cyborg realizes that he's actually better suited for a different team.
It's piece of time.
Ooh, yeah.
Yeah, and that was pretty much it. It was pretty fun, and it gave a little light of hope at the end of the movie. Say, okay, so finally, we are going to get rid of this sucker, and he's going to be put where he belongs. And I think that a good combination, the only thing that I don't happen to see how they can connect or how they can work it is, you already have Blue Beetle.
Yeah.
Which we can say is pretty much doing the times of Cyborg.
I guess it's they're trying to take the one they developed from Young Justice.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, the fight is like the end of the first season of Young Justice.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe they say Blue Beetle has he's famous in the TV series.
Mm-hmm.
Not in the comics, but in this series, he has appeal,
mm-hmm.
So they take it.
Okay, and that's the risk. But the thing is that we have Cyborg, and at the end of the movie, we can say, okay, Cyborg, for the old fans, it's going to be a Titan. It's not Titans Go for those that doesn't have a brain.
But the kids that
damage.
Only watch the TV series and now the movies.
Even the kids think
for
that
the Teen Titans Go. But if they watch the movies, it's like in Titan, he's just like, he can be in the Just in the two.
Okay, yeah, you're pretty much right with that. So I think that was
he's the bridge again.
Yeah, it was pretty much like a win for the old fans. Like, okay, we have Titan, we have Cyborg, we have Raven, we have Dick. That's what Cody says. We have Starfire. And
that's the next movie, mm-hmm. Judas Contract.
And that's something, that's actually the real end of the movie, with Terra approaching the Titan's Tower, flying in a rock. And for all the shorts that have been released, all the trailers that have been released, it's not going to be the same kind of movie. We are not, from what I've seen.
No, it's a loose adaptation.
As usual.
Yeah. But more loose.
Way looser.
Way looser.
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 No, but
it has Blue Beetle.
Has Teen Titan.
Yeah, it's loosely. Loosely based. I don't like the animation too much of the
style.
No. I have issues with that one because I love the Judas Contract. But
if you're going to compare the drawings with the animation with style,
put a bit of effort on that one, no?
Actually, they have done that in, if you remember, for example, the most of the Batman animations, they respect and they do a most fixed adaptation of the drawing style of the artist for the animation.
Yeah.
In the Team Bears.
All the Team Bears, I mean, Justice League
animated.
Oh, the first one, Batman, Superman,
Public Enemies.
Public Enemies.
The style is like the comic. Darkseid War. Or,
no, it's Apocalypse.
Apocalypse. It's like Turner. So Team Bear, with Team Bruce Team, they respect the all the styles. Now is the change.
Mm-hmm. So that's pretty much what's been going on the.
On the new DC.
On the new DC animated universe.
Yeah.
Or the Jeff Jones. Universe.
Jeff, and I'm the boss, John.
Yes. Jeff, do whatever you want. This is what we're gonna do. Uh-huh. And I hope that you enjoy and like this brief introduction to the animated universe of the DC Universe.
There is another movie that we don't talk about.
Yeah.
It's Justice League Dark. But it's exclusively for patrons. If you are a patron, you already have the commentary track exclusively. Oh,
if you like this one and you want to see, you can subscribe. You can give us a like.
Become a patron.
Yeah.
Come on.
I always wanted to do that. You can push this button somewhere around here, subscribe, or you can give us a like. Or you can become a patron.
There is no buttons.
You know that I actually am the one who has to put those and I'm not going to put them between us with you.
I always wanted to do that. But then again, and another thing that's pretty much important, as my brother said, we already have that's exclusively for patrons. We have a commentary track on Justice League Dark, which is the fifth movie, and it's already been released. It's I think it's pretty complete. It's a little bit more of an hour and a half of all of us saying the same stupid shit that you are used to listening every Wednesday
as the movie runs.
We have the commentary in real time.
Movie time
actually.
Yeah.
It's like 24 something.
Sometimes.
And before leaving you, before you start asking about the other movie, which happens to have Kirk Langstrom, the son of Zod, Jr., which happens to be Mexican, double alien, and Wonder Woman is from Apocalypse, we don't count or we don't think that it fits in this DC universe. Why? Because they are not the characters that usually being related with the characters, which Batman is not Bruce Wayne, it's Kirk Langstrom. Superman is the son of Zod, he's Kryptonian, but he's not the son.
He's not Kal-El,
actually. And the twist of this, almost at the end of the movie, is shocking. If you haven't seen it, I don't know what the fuck are you waiting for. It's a must-see, it's a must-have, it's a must. Not with us, but just go gather with your friends, have a coffee, comment it, and that was pretty much it. Huh?
And well, you remember that this is actually something that we're releasing. It's in English. We have, if you support us in Patreon, we actually have one of the purposes that we have is that we can do shows in English if we get enough patrons. But also, we are going to get something to cut the hand that is crossing my shot. And just remember, visit patreon.com/D-Strip-Ando. If you don't remember, don't worry, it will be in the text below or in the bottom, somewhere around here. See you the next
That's
time.
That's pretty appealing.